Welcome to Belkin's Growth Podcast, hosted by Michael Maximoff, co-founder and managing partner at Belkin's. Today's guest is Jake Dunlap, entrepreneur, angel investor, and CEO at Scaled Consulting, a taxes-based management consulting firm that for 8 years has been helping companies operationalize key aspects of their sales and marketing organization. Michael and Jake talk about the challenges of the service industry and exchange thoughts on how to run and grow a profitable agency. This is part two of our series of podcasts about the agencies, and it is recommended for agency owners and young entrepreneurs thinking about starting their own business. Enjoy listening.
Let's talk about how to grow the people business, how to start one, what challenges you can expect. One of my latest episodes, though, with Tom Liebold, he runs the SEO agency out of New York. While we were discussing the topic of building service consulting business, Tom's argument was that it is a low margin, high churn venture, which basically brings only sweat and pain to every CEO and founder running the business. And considering that you've been running Scaled Consulting for the past 7 years, I think that basically the first question that I wanted to bounce off you, is it really a true statement that building an agency brings only sweat and pain for those who are in business?
That's a good one, dude. Yeah, we can get into that for sure. So, I mean, yeah, it is. But I mean, look, the key, what's the alternative, right? The alternative is you're working somewhere where, you know, which I think a lot of people should work somewhere, right? So don't, just because you hear something like that doesn't mean that you shouldn't, that it's not for you, right? I mean, maybe you like it. Maybe like that'll make you more happy in your day-to-day or in the long game. So yeah, especially as you start to figure out how to scale revenue outside of yourself. I think once the non-referral based engine even starts to work, it's just like, you know, life gets way better. So my advice is, if you're going to start a business, look, by the way, we're still not there yet. We've got like the beginning kernels of it, and it's been 7 years, right? So, gosh, the amount of false starts we've had and like times I thought we had it, et cetera. So you don't know how long it's going to take. So don't give up too soon either. So yeah, no, I think that that's a quasi accurate statement, but you also need to include the flip side, which is that you probably built an agency around something that you love. You know, you're giving people jobs, you're making a difference, you know, in your world. So I think all those things, you know, to me, are, you know, far outweigh it.
Do you guys yourself, or maybe, you know, some agencies that are out there that have high margins, high growth, and they tackle the challenge that you have a high churn and so on and so forth. Do you have an example?
Yeah, I mean, I think that that's one of the most difficult parts about running a consulting firm is the nature of it. The nature is very project-based. And I think we've done a really good job over the last 2 years of basically doubling our kind of average contract length, you know? And I think, you know, you're surprised. I think most people are nervous. Like, what if we went to a 6-month contract or an annual contract? Or what if we went to month? What would churn look like, you know? So I think you got to kind of play with the model early on. You know, I think a lot of people are very, very surprised at how many people are willing to go to a longer commitment once you actually have the moxie to go and ask them to do it. And then the other thing is just being smart about creating products that can be reoccurring. So our digital presence group, for example. So, you know, we have really in our group, think of what we do is we work with companies to help with their people, their processes, and their technology. So on the people side, that's everything from compensation, hiring, how do you build and scale, you know, the people side of it. And we actually do, you know, some hiring as well too. On the process side, there's demand generation, and that's where our digital presence products come in, which is how do you generate more interest with clients, whether that's, you know, email, calls, LinkedIn. And so we've developed some, you know, some reoccurring products around that, you know, where it makes sense for us to continue to work with your team over time and forever because we're taking work off their plate, we're showing results. The rest of the work we do is on the sales process side where that has been less repeatable, right? So think about consulting with someone around demand gen. They always want more and more and more leads. There's always more things to optimize. Well, once we come in and like write your new sales playbook or implement a new sales methodology, you kind of need to like just do it, right? Like, and then like by nature, we kind of like go away and then maybe we come back in a year and do some other stuff. And then the third piece is sales operations, which again has been another reoccurring business for us, which is, look, you have a small sales operations team or marketing ops team. You need someone who can implement all your technology, optimize that technology stack. You know, you don't really have a strong ops team. You know, you want to keep us on from a retainer standpoint to continue to do that. So I bring that up because, you know, we've got a mix right now of more project-based work and retainer-based work. And, you know, I think that that's the goal for any kind of company is how do you create a people business that has monthly reoccurring revenue to some extent. And I think if I was starting scaled over, and I kind of am with some of our digital presence, I am laser focused on only repeatable revenue type projects that I already know the big other projects we can sell, like LinkedIn and digital presence playbook, you know, where a big company might pay hundreds of thousands and small companies might pay 10, 20. That I know we can do all day long as a one-off, but I'm focused on what's the value that we can bring to sales organization or marketing to where they will never get rid of us. And I think that is a really tough product to find in a people business in particular.
So let me quickly sum this up. So one of the main challenges for people business is the cash flow, right? Like how do you make money every month, right? And what you're saying is that you first need to figure out the best business model that includes the recurring revenue. So if you can make money on a continuous basis every month per client, then you can grow more. And then for you to get to the point where you can get the recurring revenue from clients, you need to, you know, instead of offering a project-based work, you need to kind of package your services in a product and offer as That's a right. kind of product.
That's right. Yeah. I mean, and you kind of bundle it in a way that people are used to buying. So, you know, we kind of on our digital presence, we work with marketing organizations, and that's more like it's much more like an agency where we're supporting them. But, you know, we like to think of ourselves as strategy and a lot more than that. And on the sales side, look, they're used to buying like per rep, per seat for technology. So if we can sell something that's like per rep, it's how they're familiar buying it. And so if it's, you know, $50 a month or $100 or $200 a month, they can then compare it mentally to something else. The more that you can think like that, hey, what are the other products that people are buying? And how can I package the services we do into something that looks like that? That makes it easier for them to say yes. But the other thing that just around cash flow that I think is important is get a line of credit. You're not taking on debt. A line of credit you pay off almost immediately. I think, you know, look, you're going to have to take chances from time to time. And the entrepreneurs that I see struggle and struggle and struggle and struggle are the entrepreneurs that don't understand that to grow your business, you know, go look at Apple. Apple to me is the most like perfect example. Do you know how much cash Apple has on hand? Do you have any clue? I'm going to give you a hint. It's a lot of fucking money, right? But let me do this. Let me just look. I'm just going to Google this so I can give it to you in real time. Apple debt, right? Debt to equity ratio. Apple's debt to equity ratio. Apple values the company's worth to 1.2, jumped from 50% to 112%. So that's their debt, right? Is 112% debt to equity ratio, right? 1 to 1.5. And I think, like as a small business owner, that's kind of terrifying, you know, like, oh my God, we have debt. And it's like, well, how highly leverages Amazon? Amazon is considered to have, since equity is smaller, Amazon is considered to have high leverage. Most common amongst large cap because debt can often be a less expensive alternative to equity. Right. So right. I think that's it. So going back kind of long story short here, and we're kind of doing this on the fly, but I think like, look, you got to be okay with that. That look, if you're trying to grow a business, you're going to have to deal with that stress too. What's it going to look like when you got $400,000 or $500,000 in debt? Like, oh my God, da da da. And there's some like metrics and ratios you can look at to know if that's good or bad, but you got to be able to roll with that. And there's a lot of things that come up as you grow and scale. And we don't use debt to finance stupid things, but you know, again, it's cheaper than giving equity, and it's cheaper than, you know, a lot of other forms of cash. So it's those are the things that you learn over time.
Right, right. And what should be a healthy margins for the recurring month-to-month revenue and for project-based work in people's business?
Yeah, and I'm going to give you gross margin, not like, you know, after the office and all that stuff. Like that brings it down quite a bit. And I can tell you our target profitability there too. That's fine. We try to target 60 to 75%. You know, our reoccurring revenue products usually have a higher margin, but on our projects, we target, you know, around 60% margins, which that's our goal.
So the project margins are lower and the recurring money that you're making have higher margins, right?
I think it's important to bucket the project revenue because think of there's different types of projects. Training for us, and again, keep in mind we're sales consulting and sales and marketing consulting. Training, the margins are ridiculous. So if we're doing a training project, the margins are stupid. But if it's more of a playbook or something like that, it depends, man. The good part about a services business is it's whatever the market will bear. So like you can do it. I was talking to the team yesterday and we're trying to create a new bundle for our digital presence clients for like after they kind of go through our phase one. And we're like, well, what about this? And I'm like, guys, just ask. It's like you can just go and the market will tell you, like, guys, this is ridiculously expensive. And if everyone is saying yes, you're not charging enough. Right. So that, you got to kind of triangulate to what your market will bear and kind of push the envelope from time to time too.
Right. Although the challenge of the recurring, let's say 70% margin, program, right, is that you always need new people to maintain the growth, right? Because if you have an agent that is making, let's say, you're making $50,000 or $100,000 per agent, and you're spending, let's say, $30,000 per agent. So you're making 70 grand, let's say. So if you want to make additional 70 grand, you need another agent, right? So you always need to scale. Is that the true statement?
Disagree? Not as much as some of the reoccurring stuff. It really, your business really depends on it. So it's like, it's a good question, right? Now, here's the thing on the consulting piece. Yeah, it scales like that. A person only has 40 hours to work. I can only bill them for 90% of that or 80% of that. I can't physically make any more money off of that. So my margins are fixed. But on the services, on a reoccurring, it's more of like you can have up to X hours for Y, or you can have up to whatever. And so one person can take on more because the work varies. Or you can make your services more tech enabled. So like PwC, massive consulting firm, KPMG, both two members like the big four consulting firms, they have made a massive push over the last few years to start to white label other technologies. And we're doing that similar with the social media data product around LinkedIn that's we feel is unique in the market. Because again, selling software has good margins and they're reoccurring. So you're even seeing big consulting firms add in a technology layer. And we have a handful of technology partners as well too, that kind of we can bolt on a managed service component. So that is always a good business, and that those types of businesses have been around for a long time.
So that gives you that additional margin level per person or for the recurring revenue. Okay. They're basically, two types of companies, right? Those that are pushing for increasing their equity or their total turnover, basically just pushing the growth. And then those that wants to make more money per person, right? So do you think that in consulting or service business, you need to maximize your profits and take money out of the business and just, reinvest, or you basically take money out of the business and invest somewhere? However, you need always to focus on the revenue that you are making per person and maximizing that revenue, if that makes sense.
I think the last part is the most important part about what you said. If you focus on that revenue per head, it's tough to really get out too far over your ski. It's tough to really like mess it up too bad. The rest of it, it's totally light. It's a choice, man. Like, dude, you could run a really cool like 5-person agency and like have that thing spit out $1 million in free cash flow. It's not scale. It may not scale like that, but you've got 3 or 4 people that have been with you for a long time and you just make a ton of money off it. Or if you want to grow, then yeah, you need to decide on if you're going to reinvest that money or if you're going to take it out and go spend it on, a new car or a house or a yacht or whatever the hell it is. Right. And for me, I've never taken that. Like, I'm playing a long game here, right? I'm trying to build this, our organization, up to a point where, we either have the right selection of tech partners to where I can build, I feel like I can have a clear path to build a $50 to $100 million business, or feel like we've got like the right mix to find like the right partner who's much bigger than us. And, I've never not wanted to build a company, but I think you've got to be very intentional about that very early on. What is this going to be? Is this to spit off free cash flow for you and do something that you really enjoy? Amazing. Don't listen to some of the things I talked about around debt, et cetera. If it's the alternative, then it's just a different choice. Neither is right or wrong.
When you talk about basically building the business for the sake of making profits and taking the cash out of the company, and that's great, right? You just make some cash, and you know, you enjoy your life. From the hiring perspective, though, how you can communicate that with your team, right? With your employees, basically, like that, you know, that we are making money here. How their motivation, how their, you know, like salary structure should look like to kind of to justify and motivate that to work, you know, extra hours, put some work, be result oriented. Can you give me some insights into what the structure that you guys have?
I can't, man, because that's not my jam. That's not how we roll. Like, I don't do that, right? So for me, I can't give you an advice on how to keep people motivated or set a vision when they know that they're just, they're literally working for your pro. Well, I guess all of them kind of know that a little bit, you know, that like, you know, I'm the owner of the company, but I think the more that they see you invested, you know, leading from the front, then that's probably the only chance that you have, you know. But if they see you constantly doing all this stuff and you're not working, you know, like that's it. If you're in there busting your ass 50, 60 hours a day or a week, and you know, people see that you're motivated, you're bought in, et cetera, you have a vision for the business, the mission you want to accomplish, that you got to focus on those things. If instead, you know, you start to become absentee, you're in there 10 hours a week, then people are going to start, you're going to have churn and people resent you.
Should you also connect their kind of salaries or KPIs to the bonus system? Like, okay, if you hit those targets, you can make that bonus or that bonus per sure. quarter or per year.
Absolutely. Yeah. Or if you have, or if you're okay to give away equity, you know, even like a small, you know, a part of it. Most services businesses are structured in a way where, you know, the equity is only worth something when the company sells or goes public, right? So, you know, if they're bought in, et cetera, and you know, you give them a certain amount of equity, then they're vested in the long-term success as well too. So I think it's either cash bonus or equity. Those are kind of levers that I have as an owner, right? I can give people bigger bonus, or I could go to someone and say, hey, look, you know, it's a $50,000 bonus or whatever. Do you want, you know, X shares or equity? You know, so those are levers that you have as a leader too.
Right. So once you figure out the cash flow question, right, in my opinion, there are two more challenges, the hiring and the scalability. So yeah. So the hiring, I mean, you know, it's people business, right? So you always need to find the best people that are out there. So let me put that in a different perspective. While building the business for the past 7 years, going back in time to whenever you started, what mistakes you wouldn't do in hiring that you see that it led to some problem that you have in 7 years?
I'll start with marketing. Marketing, I think, had been like the bane for a long time. I think we're in like an amazing spot now. Like we've been really fortunate over the last like 8 months. We've got some really good people in, but it's taken a long time. And look, it's not even their fault. I think what happens with a growing company, you tend to push too much responsibility on people who aren't ready for it. And so you got to just be honest with yourself. You might want it more for this person, for them to grow, et cetera. And I think a lot of times when you hire people and you're growing, you kind of put too much responsibility on them. And you got to be smart about that. And so I think that's a mistake I've made in marketing in particular, is hiring people and putting them into roles they've never been in before. And, you know, they're not always set up for success. But I think we've finally fixed that. So that's candidly probably one of the biggest things, is just meeting people with where they're at talent-wise and getting them a path. And, you know, you as the owner, you feel the stress of payroll and those things, but you got to meet people where they're at and grow with them and help them to grow and give them the opportunities, but don't expect them to be, you know, not drop balls or do this stuff if they've never been a VP of marketing, you know, like shit, like it's just what's going to happen. You know, right. So I think that those are a lot. I mean, and then I think, you know, we're pretty good at this, dude. Like you got to be ruthless in the interview process. Like it's going to be really easy to see like, oh God, it'd be so great. Like if we hired Michael, like, oh, then we don't have to worry about this or that. But dude, the amount of time you invest in people who don't work out, there's no comparison.
You were the only stakeholder in the company, right? So you started out the company just yourself. And who were the first people that you hired? And you were wearing many hats from the start, right? So you were doing marketing, sales, working with clients, building the products, right? At what point of time you say, okay, I need to delegate this? Or you start delegating from the beginning?
That's a really good one too. Look, the right answer is anytime something is somewhat repeatable. Right. Once you get a part of your business to where it's okay or serviceable, then that's a good time, because then someone's coming into a system. The other thing is areas where you have no idea. Like let me give you a perfect example of this. We, for the first time, hired a part-time CFO. We had these, like, you know, kind of a few people here or there in January. And the peace of mind that I have now in a month and a half is so much worth it, you know, from an investment standpoint. And I think there's those things that you just don't know what you don't know. I think finance and operations for a lot of people are those things. And so you just got to be honest with yourself. Do you know what you're doing there? So I think those are the things that I think I've learned for sure.
Did you delegate the marketing from the beginning or?
Yeah, I don't think you can. I mean, in particular, when you start a company, whether it's a technology company or services company, candidly, it doesn't matter. You need to know what the customers are reacting with. You need to know what, you know, what a customer says on a sales call or a current customer says about your product or what you're doing. So I don't think a founder for a while can divorce themselves from sales or marketing. You need to, or unless you have a co-founder, right, who's like strong and that's their jam. Because you need, that's all about the product. You know, like how your, it's like product and what are the four P's of marketing? It's product, packaging, pricing. Oh man, there's another P. I don't remember what it is, but you know, like that's you gotta get in there and know that. What are people saying about your product? Is it working? You know, like again, like I've just, you know, if I wasn't in the trenches with my team as we're kind of launched this new group, they'd be at a deficit for sure.
Right. Yeah. So you start the company, you take care of marketing, you take care of sale, you hire a part-time CFO or someone to take care of the finances and legal stuff. And then you bring the first client, then you start working with that client, you hire someone to take care of some of the day-to-day, right? Like to deliver the service or something, if you have a package or something, right? Like for example, if you're running a marketing agency and you are doing an SEO service or advertising or PPC or something, right? You have someone like on the advertising side, but then you still continue working with the client, right? Then you have two clients. So at some point you need to hire.
You got to get out of it. Like the key is, so I'll tell you what it is. You hire people who have already done the job. So you look, you're hiring an SEO, you know, like you're a marketing agency. Don't promote a marketing manager with 2 years of experience. Go pay the extra 10. That would be another thing. Pay the extra 20 grand. Like just pay it. Your 3 years from now self and your 6 months from now self will thank you. I think sometimes we get dollar wise and pound foolish, you know, or penny wise, pound foolish. And, you know, I feel like a lot of people don't take the time to really do that. You know, they don't take the time to be smart about that. That really you hire cheap and, you know, serviceable versus good and slightly more expensive. And I think that is a lesson I've probably learned too many times the hard way.
So you need to put an extra dollar while hiring an experienced person, plus put some options on the table, right? Or some...
You don't have to do the option. Yeah, I wouldn't worry about the option. People have got to be there for a while. Like I wouldn't worry as much about the options. If you have to use it as a lever, then do it, right? Like it's just another lever that you have that you can use, you know, if you need it.
Then you start making money, right? And you're making, let's say, $100,000 or $50,000 or something. And then what is the expense structure? So how much money should go to the salaries? How much money should go to marketing? You know, I'm in this business, right? And I'm always struggling should I optimize the expenses on salaries? Should I kind of push more into growing the monthly, you know, the cost of services, cost of goods, and then adding some additional expenses for marketing or, you know, what do you think the most realistic ratio between salaries, cost of sale, cost of marketing, additional expenses, not to go underwater?
So like, let's say you're able to maintain 50% margins on your business, right? Like 50% after all your consulting. Then let's say you have overhead of like support staff, marketing, operations. Let's say that's another 25%. Let's say it's another like 15% of just headcount, right? Then you've got marketing spend. You know, marketing, I would say you're probably going to need to spend 10%, 10 to 15. And that could be everything from your website to whatever it is. So I'd say then, you know, look, you're at, you know, 20% margin. Dude, if you're in a services business and you're doing a 20% drop to your bottom line, you're crushing. If you're at 10%, you're not dead, but it's tough. It can be more difficult. So I think you want to try to get between, you know, if you can get to 12 to 15, you're in like a good spot after all that. After sales, marketing, rent, all that, our target is, you know, 15%. That's what we're aiming for.
Is it 15% before paying yourself or after?
Well, it depends on what you mean by pay yourself.
Do you have like a salary in the company that you pay yourself?
Yeah, you have to pay yourself a salary. But no, you get to take draws, which means there's some tax benefit to that for sure. Uh-huh. So But no, look, I have probably in my company right now, and I would say that this is true for the last 3 years plus, I have at least 1, 2, 3, 4 people that make more money every year than I do. I'm not like, oh, you know, so-and-so. I don't give a shit, man. Like, I own, you know, most of the business. So like, there's a lot of other things that go into it. So I think for a lot of people, you can't also expect anyone to, you know, care about that, you know, like I don't expect anyone to care about that, that they're like, oh, well, I know Jake doesn't, you know, like, no, it's a choice. If I wanted to make more money, I'd make more money. I'd just like not hire somebody, or I'd fire somebody and just take their salary.
You made a decision, right? You made the call. So
right. I want to make more money tomorrow than I, there comes a point though, you know, I think we're kind of at it. We'll do over, I don't know, we'll end up this, you know, this year, hopefully we'll be closer to like 6 to 8 million somewhere in there. And, you know, but it's, again, it's taken a long time to get here. And, you know, now we're kind of at that point where we're not dealing with a lot of the stresses, but it just takes time. And the smarter you are and more deliberate you are early on, like I think we could have probably got here in 4 years instead of 7. But I got distracted early on with like this line of business and this line of business and, oh, we can do a little of that. And I still am constantly, you know, questioning myself and asking myself like, okay, are we spread too thin? You know, are we not focused enough? Right now we've got kind of these three business, you know, like shit, like, am I doing it? I'm like, well, they're all profitable. So it's like, you know, like they're all profitable or like on a clear path to profitability. So I'm like, okay. And it's like, then like, okay, Jake, don't go dream up some other shit. You know, don't distract your people. That would be my other big piece of advice. Like, dude, don't be like, oh, well, I bet Johnny's got some excess capacity. Here you go. That's the other thing I think that really demotivates people. They don't mind being a jack of all trades for the first 6 months. They might like it. But after a while, I had a lot of churn of people who stayed, you know, like just at a year or either right over or right under early on. And I had them doing like 7 different things, man. They're working on this type of client and this type of client and that. And, you know, some of the feedback I got from the exit interviews was, you know, I was just, you know, I was running like a chicken with my head cut off. I was doing too many things. So that would be my take on that too.
To sum up, when you hire someone, you need to clearly kind of identify that the job of the person within the organization and make sure that that person develops her or his own skills in that job through entire time in the company without running with the burning ass basically, right, in the company and doing all the this crazy
shit. It's like, look, you need to plug a hole here or there. So if I'm like, hey, Courtney, I need you to go to this event, like that's not a big deal. But if you do that every week to people, they'll get burnout. If every week you're like, hey, I need you to do something that's like completely out of your job scope, people will eventually burn out. And it doesn't mean that they're bad people and that they can't hack it or whatever. It means that that's not how people want to operate. You know, I enjoy it-ish. Like there's certain things I hate. Like I don't like, I can do it. I have my MBA. I can build spreadsheets. I can do, you know, cash flow and IR. I can do all kinds of shit, but I hate it. Like really.
Do you personally interview every person joining your company right now?
Not anymore. No, I've got people in different leadership roles that there's a few. I mean, I still probably interview 90% of people.
90% of people?
Yeah, probably 90%. It was probably 100% a year ago. Now it's like we've got a person who's doing a really great job and I never interviewed him. I think he was probably one of the first people. So I'd say, yeah, it's very recent that I've come down to like 90%.
The reason I'm asked, I was wondering, are there any clear patterns into, you know, hiring a person in the people's business that you clearly see they wouldn't fit or that they fit?
Yes.
And you know, like, okay,
that's
when I talk
easy.
To them,
that's
I
easy.
Know that they, so what are they?
They came from a big company. If your only work experience is Salesforce or your only work experience is Oracle, there is a very high likelihood you're not going to just understand this pace. You're not going to understand the building of things versus the executing of things. So I look for people who have been builders. They've built something. They started their own company. They went and worked a startup before Oracle and they liked it, you know, but now they learned some structure working at Oracle or whatever. So I think if they don't have a track record before you of ever building something, I don't think you can hire them. Or in the early days in particular. And now when the processes are built out, right, then you can hire an executor. So you just got to be smart about where your company, where your business is at.
That one. Anything else?
Like definite no hire. you know, don't get too hung up on the culture. I mean, some companies are. I mean, we have a very diverse group. We're a sales consulting agency, and I think we're like 55, 60% women to men. And I would say too many people early on look for people just like them, as opposed to people with different backgrounds, different thought processes who have done similar roles, but maybe they're not the same as you. And so I think that helps at times, you know, it can help to have like a more diverse kind of like group of people. So don't over index on just what made you successful in that role. Think about what anybody would need to be successful out, like independent of you, and then focus on like those things. So that would be maybe one other piece of advice.
Beautiful, beautiful. And then the last kind of comment or question for this particular item about hiring. When you hire someone, right, and they start working with you, do you guys have an onboarding process or a mentorship process? And how would that look to make sure that the person can get up to speed, can perform, and you can basically generate the revenue or, you know, put that person into action? What is the soonest time that you can do that?
And again, it depends on what the role is, right? You know, senior consulting is going to take longer than, you know, managing someone's LinkedIn, for example. So for us, we are big believers in a very regimented onboarding process. You know, we used to have a process that was like so regimented where your first 2 weeks, you walked out of the scale with your head spinning. We were so thorough that like, you know, you were just like, whoa. And then what we found is that people were then having to go back and ask the same questions to people that had already walked them through a training or whatever it is. And we realized like that was too much. So what we do is we have the first week, if not the first and second week, 100% scripted from an hour standpoint. But what we don't do in there is try to make sure that you've met every single group, you've met every single whatever. You know, it could just be that your time spent really getting to know your job and your current team in that 2 weeks. And then over the course of the next 2 months, we have these, what we call the scaled difference sessions. And the scaled difference is basically introductions to different parts of our business and what they do. And so any new hire just signs up for like that month or that every 6 week scaled difference session. So that's kind of what we do there. And that we found that this, at least so far, we've got maybe like a handful of people that we've either put through it or are putting through it.
What is the onboarding period there? Is it 3 months? Is it 6 months? What's the time that you need to wrap up a person?
It depends on the job. I mean, like we hire people with experience, right? So I'm not hiring someone who, you know, has never talked to someone about sales before or led a sales team. So what we try to do very early on is put people in positions they can win fast. So for us, like, you know, I would expect one of our consultants can start to take on smaller engagements in the first, you know, month. Now toward the end of it, or with like a number working as a number two, and then hopefully after 6 to 12 months they can start to lead projects. You know, that's kind of the time frame that we look at. That we'll pair them up with a more senior person where they can do a lot of behind the scenes work for 6 to 12 months, and then they're usually ready. There's some people who are again, but we're also a meritocracy. Like if you're good, you're good. Like you can start leading projects in the first month. You know, so it's just, you know, where you're at from a skill standpoint.
Beautiful. Okay. So we figured out the cash flow, the hiring.
Everything,
right? The last but not least, you know, in my kind of top three challenges is the scalability. What are the healthy numbers that we need to keep in mind? What are the targets to make sure that the business is not, you know, stagnating? So you said that you're going to be making between 6 to 8 mil this year, and it's your seventh year. So what were your trends and how do you see, you know, these trends can be different? What is the healthy trend for the agency to grow?
Look, here's what I would say. Assuming you haven't raised a bunch of outside money and it's your money, let the business tell you when it's ready to grow, right? Like, again, you figure out a repeatable process for generating new meetings. Okay, cool. Now you can hire someone to do that. Now you know between your work and that person's work, you're going to have X percent more, so you can do X, Y, Z. What we stopped doing this year, we stopped doing last year, was putting goals in place that were like guesses, right? Like, yeah, we did, you know, 3 million this year. We're going to do 8 million next year. And like, candidly, like, I don't think we really even figured that out until like maybe 9 to 12 months ago. So I just think, look, don't let ego get in the way. Don't let going to talk to your friends and how many employees you have get in the way. I think those are the things that I see hurt people more than anything. is they try to scale too quickly. And I, dude, we did it too. I mean, I definitely made some mistakes on hiring too many people from time to time, or not waiting until the business caught up to go start something, you know, like an extension of what we're doing. You know, my advice is let the business tell you when you're ready to scale. Don't feel like you have to run your business like a, you know, a software company or like, you know, anybody else's business. You're not those business. So choose the type of growth you want. If, you know, if you can kill yourself, you know, you're like, man, I'm going to kill myself and we're going to try to grow whatever. And you only grow 20%, like, okay, you know, like, cool, just grow 20% again next year. You don't have to have 300, you know, again, I'm not venture backed. You know, if I don't grow 200% year over year, you know, the only thing that takes a hit's my ego, right? Like, I don't get fired or replaced or whatever. Like, as long as things afloat, everyone's paid on time, everyone's happy, you know, everyone's doing their job, everyone's excited, then I can choose not to grow. If you said, Jake, look, take a parallel year. If you said, look, Jake, instead you're going to do the same amount of revenue you did last year, but all the right people are in place, all the right systems are in place, you've got marketing, everything's humming, I would say, okay, like, not ideal, but like, I'm good with it. I'm not also like beating. I'm not like, God, we didn't grow. I can't go tell mom and dad I hired people. You know, I think that honestly, that's what I see sink more people than anything.
Right. So you can get to the point where you're healthy as a business and you don't need to grow. At the same time, you don't have that extra hustle that you're doing just to keep on business floating, right? So you can be at the same.
Do whatever you want. You don't have to want to hustle. Like, I don't care. That's why you start a people business. You start it so you can have control. You can do something that you really enjoy. And if you really enjoy sitting on a beach, then cool. If you really enjoy taking trips, cool. If you instead want to grow, like, fine. I really don't care what people want to do. There's ways that you can scale that it's more difficult in a people business. A lot of your business comes for referrals. So until it's impossible to scale until you figure out how to scale referrals or new business, right? It's impossible. So until you figure those things out, all your scaling and your new targets are just based off of bullshit and like guesses. So you either, or you're like, look, my organic continues to grow incrementally. I now know after a couple years, I can count on this. Then you control your own destiny.
It's been great. I think that I have two more things that I wanted to bounce off you. First is that, do you need to get external investment, right? Do you need to raise money to for the agency? Who are investing in agencies, right? Do you need just to, as you mentioned, you need to have a credit line and that's it. Can you take a debt on the company, or should you have someone like a VC, well, not necessarily VC, like an angel or someone else to invest in your company, right? And then the second question, if you can answer both, is what is the perfect exit strategy? Is there any, I mean, like not the perfect, but what are the typical, you know, if, you know, you've been in business for like 7+ years in this particular, yeah, in this space, right? So what are the typical exit strategies in place there for agencies like yourself?
Okay, well, there's a few questions in there. I'll try to give you my best on some of this stuff. No, you don't need to take outside money. Not at all. There's, you know, do you want to give up control? Do you want to do that? Like, these are all very personal decisions, like I said before. Like, no, you don't need to take on outside money. Like, when to take it on, you know, you want to mitigate some of your growth and you're okay to give up some equity. You want to mitigate some of your cost or expenditure and you want to mitigate some of that, right? So if you don't want to, you don't have to. You know, you can use the proceeds from the business to fuel growth. That's fine. And then I think, look, your choices are sell to a smaller competitor regionally. And really all they're going to buy is your book of business, right? Or your IP. And so here's the thing to understand. You don't have a book of business that's stable, or you are such a dynamo that people would pay a premium for you. But if you don't have a book of business that's stable, or you don't have you don't have proprietary IP, your company's not actually worth a ton. Like, even if you are doing a few $1 million a year or 10 million bucks, even if you're doing $20 million a year, but it's 100% project based and those clients aren't reoccurring and it's not proprietary and your people don't have a proprietary set of skills, then your company's not actually worth that much. So you got to think about what are the things that you're doing. You know, for us, we're creating kind of a sales methodology. We're creating these reoccurring revenue products. Not that I'm like positioning to sell, but I know that that's what we need for healthy business too. And so, you know, you got to decide what you want to do. If you're just going to continue to go from project to project with no reoccurring clients, then your business isn't going to be worth much. And that's just something I think, you know, a lot of people need to keep in mind.
To sum up, so you need to have a business book of reoccurring businesses that pay you. You need to have a proprietary...
or super proprietary tech.
Not tech.
Or IP, intellectual property. Like for us, like we're building out our own scaled methodology. So if you're a company now, and as we have this thing, you're buying that if you ever bought scaled.
And then you need to make profits, right? So if you let's say you're making, you have a 2 million in gross revenue and you are making, let's say 20% of that. The next year you have like 5 and you're making like 20-25%. The next year you have 7 and you're making also 20%. So your profits are growing. So it makes sense for someone to buy your business because they know that in the next 3 years, they will kind of have return on the investment, like quadruple or double their return, right? So it makes sense for them to kind of to buy what you're worth in 3 years, right? There can be some kind of multiplicator there.
Yeah, and that's not, well, here's what I'd say. You're not going to get that on a services business, right? Unless you have those things. If you have those things, then there's a chance maybe you'll get some type of multiple. Normal service business, you're getting 1x top line, maybe 3-4x EBITDA. Like you're not, this ain't tech. You ain't getting 10x here. Unless you have those things that look proprietary like a tech, then you're stuck at probably 1-2x max if you can convince them, or then maybe you're going to get to 3 or 4 of your current revenue, not some, you know, future, whatever it is. Nobody's looking at a people business based off of future because guess what? It's all project-based. So you got to go recreate that future. If you've got a consistent base of customers that I know going into year two, I'll have that, then that's why I pay you a premium.
And then the most common kind of exit strategy, is it the merging or acquisition?
Either being acquired is probably by far in the services business. That the agency that's like right up the food chain from you is, you know, kind of acquires you. So for us, you know, we've got about, we've got like all in maybe what, 25, 30 people. So for us, it would be, you know, a consulting firm that has a few hundred, like 150 people and is looking to add in, you know, maybe it's a marketing consulting firm that's looking to add in sales consulting, right? Or something like that, right? Like then we would be an attractive target to them. So that's more often than not, you know, until you scale to become, you know, a few hundred employees, and that's when the big people start to pay attention.
We hope you've enjoyed this episode of Belkin's Growth Podcast and found it useful. Be sure to subscribe and catch upcoming episodes on iTunes and Stitcher.